Hello and welcome to The She Word, the show where we discuss topics trending among women across Africa. Women like you, and of course, women like us. With me today is Griselda Grootsboom. Well, you've heard from her. She's a survivor, a global survivor actually, a leader in human trafficking, and author of the amazing book called Exit. I also have the pleasure of introducing Chinazom Enyi from Nigeria.
How na deo?
Oh, my brother, there. She's a Nigerian blogger, a fitness coach, and finally, I have Sharon.
I feel like I should say Hakuna Matata because everybody said something cool from their language.
Sharon is a BBC journalist, and my name is Shefa Okoye. I'm an Afro-political feminist, and I'm vice chair of Ukweli Party. Today, we're talking about a topic that has got all of us on our heels. Sharon.
Yeah, guys, we're going to be talking about the recent and brutal murder of a girl, a Kenyan girl called Sharon Otieno. Now, Sharon was in a relationship with an older married man, a regional governor for that matter, called Okoth Obado, who was reportedly buying her a house. Mm. Now, the killing has shed light on relationships where older men financially support young women that they're intimate with. And these men, of course, in South Africa are called blessers. In Kenya, they're called sponsors. And they're called sugar daddies in Nigeria. Her murder has really provoked anger from women online, from women on the streets. And they're saying that the sponsor's way of life is putting many, many women at risk.
It's dusk in Nairobi, the capital of Kenya. A crowd gathered to pay tribute to a young woman killed in cold blood. They chant songs in protest over murder most foul. Sharon Otieno, a 26-year-old university student in Kenya, was 7 months pregnant when she and the baby she was carrying were killed. Her murder is under investigation, and the facts of the case are far from clear. At the night vigil, attendees demanded justice for not only Sharon, but other young girls.
Justice for you, Tabitha. We're going to get justice for you, Sharon. Most recent, most horrible. This is not a country of hyenas.
Yes.
This is a country of people.
Sure.
Yes. Sharon's death has lit a conversation in East Africa with a cross-section of people questioning lifestyle choices by young women in the continent.
No woman chooses to die. To even talk about choice when a woman is murdered is... it's unspeakable.
Criminalizing Sharon for me does not make any sense. And the whole thing, people telling us it's immoral, like we have to do away with it. Like for a man, it's okay when they have as many wives, but for me, when I choose to go out with a guy I want to go out, why is it being criminalized on me?
This is murder. It's murder, but we choose to talk about the other side of how she chose to live her life.
Wow, any violent death is a matter of great sadness. And of course, for legal reasons, we can't discuss the details of this case as it's under investigation, but I'd like us to focus more on this dynamic. The dynamic of the relationship, mm-hmm. which is having a sugar daddy or a sponsor. Mm. Do you think it's okay or do you think it's not okay to be with someone who is older, potentially even married?
I don't know what are we saying about the okay, because we've already given the men their title of what they can do by calling them sugar daddy. Mm-hmm. Them themselves as men, if they go into these bars and they walk in being known as sugar daddies, and the word sugar daddy says he's giving money for a favor of sexual interaction. So we're already allowing them by having this space and place and authority over our bodies. So when we talk about just calling them a title name, it's something that we need to be careful about as women and girls. And our young kids, we're not educated in very well of what kind of relationship is probably moral and unmoral.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So yes, we're not saying and denying that you are at an older age too, but is this a moral thing to date an older man that has kids, he's married, he's a governor?
Do you think it's a good idea to date a married man?
It is totally wrong, in my opinion. Because, first of all, marriage is a sacred
Yeah, mm. marriage is sacred.
Institution mm. is a covenant between a man and a woman. Mm. And then you're dating a married man, you're trying to break into that covenant, mm. and it is totally wrong. Mm. Number two, these men don't care about you. They have a family, they have a wife, they have children. They just want to use you and just play with you. So you don't have a future with them. So think about your future, and it's just totally
wrong.
I'm curious
about how it's the responsibility of the woman.
Yeah, I was right. about, yeah.
Because mm-hmm. the married mm-hmm. man, the man is the one who's married, mm-hmm. right? Aren't they the one who are supposed to uphold this sacredness of their marriage and respect the vows and respect they have kids and respect that they're in a union, right? So before he goes out to look for Sharon, right? Shouldn't he be thinking about this? Shouldn't he be
Before
this
we
be
even
his responsibility
get more into
first?
This conversation, I think we need to take a look at what's going on social media. Because social media, I tell you, has been on fire with this story. So let's have a look at some of those reactions. Fiona Gasheri says, women should be protected and respected. The same women should also respect themselves and learn how to work for their money. Shortcuts are not always safe. Ooh. And then Stunning Peter Sunday says, the problem is not the men. It's the ladies who don't want to work hard and look for shortcuts via these sponsors. Ladies are the problem. I repeat, ladies are the problem. And then we have Abby Matei K saying, I believe that girls should say no to the so-called sponsors and now blessers. This will only happen if they develop themselves from within. A lady of substance will always respect herself. Mm-hmm. Wow, it's clear from those comments that a lot of people don't approve of sponsors as the way of life.
Completely.
You guys agree with that?
Completely. But totally. I think it's very hypocritical, though, for people
it's
to
hypocritical.
Be. I think so. Uh-huh. Because we all know that transactional relationships occur all the time. Yeah. So I think this story has made us be able to look at ourselves in the mirror and look at that thing that we all don't like, but is there.
Yeah, that's true.
I'm just sort of worried about the word choice in the previous one of, like, you know, which is probably giving, for me, mm-hmm. the hard side of what prostitution have become part mm. of sleeping with all the men, sponsors mm. and stuff. So I think the word choice is what I picked up from one of them and saying. So
you think they have no choice but to sleep with all
the
men?
I mean, you know, the previous, you know, it's one said it's so unfair mm-hmm. that we women choose to do what we want to do and then we get killed. And when men yeah. do it, nobody does it.
Absolutely.
And then the word choice is what are you choosing? Mm. And why is this becoming a choice for you now?
And
to
why
just
is that the only choice you
enslaving
have?
Enslaving yourself for the sake of money to men, you know?
Shinazam, you've been quiet. What are you thinking?
Because it's totally wrong to me. And I feel these girls are just being lazy. Trust me.
Being lazy?
Yes.
What? Girl.
Yes, they are. I mean, because we're all independent women. You just try and empower yourself.
Not every kid,
you
though.
Have hands,
that's
you have
a
legs.
Statement.
You have hands, you have legs. Do something. Get the money and pay the bills yourself.
I don't think that's true. I think that comes from a very high place of privilege. Of where you assume that everybody has the same opportunities and the same abilities and the same access and the same, you know, capabilities to thrive in these spaces, and it's not true.
Why do you stand by that so strongly?
Well, there's some women, there's some ladies, mm-hmm. pardon me, some girls that have those mm-hmm. privileges mm-hmm. and they still go with married men. They still date married men.
Well, I think by now, as we're talking about this lady, there's one lady that we need to probably listen to and hear her story.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So there's a lady called Gift Stamford, popularly known as Gigi Money, famous Tanzanian and controversial video vixen, who says the situation at home forced her to find a sponsor at the age of 17. Let's hear her out.
I was a honest, I was 17, which is, I was very young, but I was active. I was knowing what I'm doing. I was need to do that because I see my mom struggle, you know. Sometimes we just do it because we need money, but we don't love it. First time you're enjoying, honestly. You're enjoying, you get money through your body. You just like it's easy getting money. It's just easy having money. It's just even affording yourself. So you just like, I don't give an affair, but man, man is just a man to me. But at the end of the day, you'll realize you just did wrong after maybe you get pregnant. Maybe someone's get HIV then. When I need something like my daughter, she's not okay. So if I'm calling a man who used to sponsor me or he's still sponsored and I know his background, like I know your wife. So it's easy, like, baby, can I have money? I offer sex because that's all the only thing I can give. What I should give to them? Sex, because they need sex.
What made me change? Because I'm a mother and I have a kid. Myra, my daughter, changed me. I don't need her to be like me. That's it.
Oh, wow. Is it the only way to get through a difficult situation for some women? In other words, is it a lifestyle choice? Or is it no choice at all? Ladies, what do we think?
I don't know, I just looked at it and I got emotional.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I'm from there. And I'm very impressed with her of saying I changed and the advice. And then she also mentioned the choice in it, and which is something that we probably work on a lot now, where people are saying, let's try to find a particular law to accommodate this.
Yeah.
And I like that she pointed out the dangers of you doing this. So for me, it is sad for me to see our African girls going through this, and women and girls are given this option, and that makes me question why are schools not being established.
Some girls, they grew up with the privileges, they have rich parents, but they still go ahead and follow sugar daddies. So, but some of them, they grew up in poverty. Those are the ones I feel so sorry for, because I mean, sometimes it's just, that's just the only option they have. It's just a fast way to make money.
But she's very honest about something that's very difficult and very painful, and something that is used to shame women. And she said, the only thing I have to give is sex.
And for me, it's just such a sad thing that, you know, coming from that life and as a survivor, and that is her only option, where she says, I can only offer my body.
Sex. Do you think the culture of men giving money to women has given women a bad reputation?
Have men always given money to women?
Mm-hmm.
Or was it just a thing of men to provide for women?
Mm-hmm.
Because we're using a terminology that changes our morals.
Mm-hmm.
Men were taught to be fathers, to be brothers.
Providers.
And providers.
Protectors.
And protectors.
We're talking about sugar daddies, known as sponsors in Kenya and blessers in South Africa.
And this is a story of Grace, who was actually featured in BBC Africa Eye recent documentary on sugar daddies. Take a look.
I want to take her to a good school, a school that she is going to study without stress.
Penda sana.
I have a male friend, and I call him and tell him, I want to pay for my house, and I only have money for shopping. I don't have money for rent. Can you help me? So he could give me like 5K, at times maybe 7, 10. But the kind of sponsor that I need is someone that's going to help me big time, like going to change my life.
Wow.
So what I think...
Her story is a bit different from Gigi's, let's be honest.
Yeah, but what I think is that I think some of these young girls, they actually say, okay, instead of me dating a young boy that doesn't have money and I'm still giving him sex, I'd rather just...
It's coming to a social status for this lady, because she clearly wants a house and she wants to take care. And I mean, that's an everyday woman.
That?
No, we have an everyday woman. Mm-hmm. We are caring people. We maintain life. And I think this is where I agree with what she's saying, that women are lazy. At her age, you would expect by then she would be finding a job and work. And also, you know, not...
So is this not... working, or is this not a job?
It is not a job to be laying on the floor.
Grace is very intent about educating her daughter. You know, she has her own house and she's taking care of her bills, but it's not enough, right? So it's the moment of where she gets to a place of it's insufficient. And I have someone whom I can call and be like, hey, I've paid for my rent. I don't have money for food. And the thing for me is, because I'm very particular about how she comes into the picture. She says she's a single mother. She has a baby to take care of. And she's literally saying, I'm doing all I can to provide for this baby and I want to pursue other things, right? So why is it wrong for me to actually choose to seek help if this is the only way I want to
that
choose
is
to seek
not
help,
the only way. That
right?
is not
You know who
the
I'd love to hear from, guys?
No.
I'd love to hear.
No.
Like, no. No. I'd love to hear from the men.
It's not only young women who look for older men to fund their lifestyles. Young men, popularly known as Bentons in part of the continent, are dating older women and benefiting financially. This week on We've Got Mail, we are in Uganda to find out their take on sugar mummies.
I don't have one, I don't think
I would allow one to look after me, because financially I think I can be stable on my own.
It depends. If at all she's safe, we can go for blood checkups and like she's having some good money.
Having to defile my value system or go against it just so to attain something else that I can get later on. So I would say no to it.
No, I would not accept, but I think people could accept. Some people like older women, and they may not look at them as sugar mummies, they may look at them as, you know, girlfriends.
If she says there are no strings attached, then I would agree, and I think I would be okay with it. But if she says there are strings attached, I would not agree. Because, you know, some sugar mummies can really want you to have some sexual intercourse with them.
They just want young men, especially from campus, nice-looking guys.
If you are interested in a relationship, you can look for the fellow youth, not the sugar mummies, who are older than you. Some of them are older than your mother.
What do we think?
There was one guy who said that they're girlfriends, they're not sugar mummies. Uh-huh. And it's just like, what's with the double standard? Uh-huh. What is with the double standard? Uh-huh. That's my biggest question.
I mean, I like how they said, oh, well, you know, the sugar mummies could be expecting some sexual relations. What should she expect? I'm just curious.
Oh, definitely.
Right?
Yeah. One guy said, if there's no strings attached, maybe. If there's strings
attached.
No, he won't. I mean, of course he wants
something in return.
Yeah.
So you're okay with the transactional behavior?
Again, for me as a survivor, it's a normalization of prostitution male. Mm-hmm. It's selling, it's buying, it's trading. Mm-hmm. Young boys are being groomed, being taught, you know, we have the work we do on internet, and you'd hear them say, well, an older woman is maturer, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. It's another mechanism of recruitment of the sex industry.
Yeah. Still, older women still also deserve some action, and if she's got some money and she wants to
what are they
pay
again?
For it,
exactly.
Right?
How is that a problem?
That's
a very good question.
Well, if you're married and old, I'm sure you can find a man of your age in a relationship if you're a moral woman.
Well, now we've got to move on, and we've come to the time on the show when we ask you for your advice on everyday dilemmas. Okay, so everybody desires to be successful, and for many, this means not just privately achieving their goals, but also being publicly viewed as a success. There is, however, almost always a price to be paid for success. We take a look at three scenarios today, okay? Then I'll need your reactions to them, and here's the first one. Lean and Andy are married and have been for the last 8 years. But Andy's job doesn't pay as much.
Hey, Shbeb, that shoe looks very expensive. How did you afford it?
I got a raise from work. I decided to gift myself. I hope he doesn't realize this was paid by my blesser.
Oh my God.
Well, I got a raise at work.
What do you think about that lie? I got a raise at work. Do you think she could have just been honest about where she got the
she
shoes
from?
She
can't even be honest about it. So because she's married, she doesn't want her husband to know.
I'm just biting my tongue.
Where she got money from to buy those shoes, so she can't be honest about it.
Is your problem the lie or the reason
the
why
way
she lied?
This is why I'm biting my tongue.
This is why I'm biting my tongue, right?
Because I find, like, honesty so liberating. And in this moment, you're with somebody who can give you what you want. Then why are you with them? Because I feel like you're punishing this person, right? To live through an everyday way in which you're crafting a lie to show that this relationship can exist in a certain way, which it doesn't, you know? If you want somebody who buys you like Louis Vuittons and like red bottoms, get that. Don't get somebody who can't afford that, and then you want to lie to them.
Why did you get so married to a guy that you know is broke?
How about we take a look at the next reaction?
Yes,
we gotta take a look at the next reaction, ladies. So, this one is way too familiar for people in the workplace. Let's take a look.
Akila's 3-month internship is about to come to an end, but she really needs this job in order to help her ailing mom.
Now that I dropped my flag for the boss, I'm so sure I'll get that job.
I am sorry, Kayla, but we won't be extending your internship. I am so sorry.
Ooh, what about that?
For me, it's just the usual cheating.
Cheating?
Women do cheat.
Preach.
Do you understand what I'm saying? So, she's cheating for the status life, or she's cheating for the poverty life that she's struggling, and it's one of those survivor mechanisms also. And I mean, and the trend of selling your body has become the business. Mm-hmm. So the opportunity occurs when a boss has a sexual harassment to you while you're doing the intern, and then you discover, I'm about to lose my job, and he did try to hit on me. I might as well give it to him and let me keep my job. And it's one thing that we get in South Africa with our young girls coming out of graduation and having their PG and not getting jobs. They're already, you know, seduce and find ways to keep their jobs. So it's something.
Also question, I like how bosses ask for sexual favors. Should that even be allowed?
Before we even get into that discussion, I'd like you to take a look at the final scenario that we have, okay? Mm-hmm. So our final scenario will literally send you back to school, okay? Here is a typical classroom dilemma.
Chima is a final year law student, but she's been skipping school.
I have to pass these exams. My career depends on it.
Chima, you've been missing most of my classes. This doesn't look good on you and your grades.
But there is a way around it. Come a little closer.
Come a little closer.
Please, there's no guarantee she's going to get that score. There's no guarantee.
Right?
Yeah.
Right?
There's no guarantee at all.
But who's taking advantage of who here?
The teacher.
The teacher.
Really?
Yeah.
You want to tell me there are no girls who ever try and take advantage of the fact that it's a man?
It's very difficult for a young student in an institution just to throw herself to a professor because she wouldn't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But the trend of professors, lecturers, educators being sexually harassing young people while they study has been that growth.
Unexpected.
And they know, we have a lot of students in South Africa who are like, you know, I didn't want to please him, so he's giving me a bad mark.
Mm. Because it's difficult, like you said. It's really difficult to find. Like, I'm remembering when I was in uni to just throw myself at a lecturer because I want to pass a particular unit or a course.
Right.
It would be so difficult because I don't know the reaction. I don't know what I'm going to be.
They can like you.
It would be difficult, right? It would be so difficult.
I mean, I can imagine me doing my grade 11 in South Africa right now, and I'm thinking, I'm 37. I shouldn't be sitting in a class with kids that are doing grade 11, which are 19 and 16. I could probably go to the lecture and be like, you know, do me a favor. I could do that. He would probably want me to do that. And I get that kind of behavior from him. I'm thinking, you know, you could get an easy way out of this for you to get your grade. We could just be friends. And that's the dignity, low scooping that we representing, and which is the saddest thing of our institutions.
Absolutely. I agree. But we can have this conversation for a long time. It's been great talking today, but I know there's so much more to say on this topic. So please join the discussion on the BBC Africa social media platform and keep the conversation going with the hashtag BBC The She Word. Goodbye, and thank you for joining us.